I'm James Howell, and this is Eleventh Heaven Critical Suplex, an extended look at Grasshopper Manufacture's 2007 game No More Heroes, written and directed by Suda51. Heaven 3. Shinobu with Shonté Daniels. For the introduction to this episode, I want to follow up on a topic discussed in the introduction to Dr. Peace. Earlier, we looked at how No More Heroes enhances the player's bond with Travis by including us in his hygienic rituals. Now I'd like to expand on that by looking at how No More Heroes physically idealizes its characters, not to advance a stock power fantasy, but to critique the very audience that engages video game power fantasies. So, let's look at physical objectification and idealization in media. On its surface, No More Heroes is a power fantasy about a lovable loser making his way to the top. Power fantasies of this sort typically idealize their characters' physiques, and these ideals vary based on audience. Like, Marcus Fenix appeals to a very different ideal of power than, say, Travis Touchdown, but they largely function the same way. The idealized physique is an objectified physique. Bodies that fit a social ideal of beauty are pretty rare, so in media, we have to deliberately construct those ideal bodies as objects. This happens just as much in video games as it does in pornography, which will become relevant later in this analysis. There's another kind of objectification that works against the idealized body, though. It's the way we think about our real bodies as objects when we practice hygiene. When we brush our teeth or wash our hands, we treat those parts of our bodies as objects in the same way we might treat a car that we're cleaning out. This kind of objectification alerts us to the reality of our bodies, that they exist in time and space, not the eternal present of a wish fantasy, and that they require maintenance on their way toward death. Self-objectification is a buzzkill. In action video games, the player character's body, very often male, is typically idealized to represent strength and power, again, as with Marcus Fenix in the Gears of War games. More often, in Japanese games, the male physique is given an ideal of beauty as well. And we see both ideals represented in Travis, whose lank, symmetrical physique also has the musculature needed for combat. In addition to this, No More Heroes objectifies Travis's body as a thing to be hygienically maintained. That's where it gets interesting. It repeatedly calls attention to his bowel movements, to his dental care, and to his pores. These are details that fantasies are typically built to ignore, and No More Heroes counteracts Travis's idealized portrayal with these day-to-day details. We can understand this contrast in the game as part of the interplay between fantasy and reality. Travis's visually attractive body as a power object is fantasy, and his body as a hygienic object is reality. As players, we are invited to share his existence, so we're made aware of both.
It's game time!
In addition to this, No More Heroes idealizes Sylvia as a sexual object, which I distinguish from a power object. Video game players are invited to be power objects, and they're invited to have sexual objects. And Sylvia in this game definitely falls into the latter category. No More Heroes sexually objectifies her as part of the ritual of most ranking fights. After Travis pays to enter the next ranking fight, the player watches Sylvia's side of her phone call with Travis when she tells him where to go next. Most of these scenes celebrate Sylvia's body as a sexual ideal, whether here in her wardrobe indecision, here getting a massage, or here in her yoga routine. There's a kind of peep show feeling here. The audience becomes an anonymous voyeur after paying with Travis's cash. On its own, the celebration of Sylvia's body as an object doesn't stand out from the millions of other examples of sexual objectification in power fantasies. I think there's more going on here, though, precisely because the game undercuts Travis's idealization. The game calls us to doubt the reality of Travis's physical idealization, and as a consequence, we should question the reality of Sylvia's idealized form as well. I interpret Sylvia's idealized physique through the same lens I've used before. We see the world of No More Heroes as a synthesis between reality and Travis's fantasy projection. We experience the game through an unreliable narrator, Travis, and Sylvia's objectification becomes much more interesting if understood as another facet of Travis's psyche, and not one that really flatters him. Travis perceives Sylvia as an object. As soon as he's alone with her in the limo, he treats her body with the same self-indulgence that he treats his Moe poster.
Moe.
He relates to her the same way that he relates to pornography. Speaking generally, pornography requires two things. The objectification of the performer and the anonymity of the audience. Now, Travis's ability to objectify others is arguably his greatest strength. He learned to fight via correspondence course.
I watched Master Jacob's teachings on video over and over till the fucking tape wore out. We've never met in person.
He learns new wrestling moves by watching them on VHS. You know, objectification in this sense is crucial to Travis's success as a fighter, and he carries that method over to sex when he practices technique along with pornography.
It seems to be a recording of a guy humping a pillow. The video you should have returned was, How to Please a Woman in Bed 101 Part 2. Please return it to us soon. Thank you.
As an extension of this, Travis lives in a world of fantasy where everything is objectified, including other people. Once they're objectified, Travis perceives them through the lens of fantasy. You know, he objectifies his assassin opponents as bodies to kill, and through his fantasy lens, he understands them as anime-style enemies, and the conflicts as anime-style conflicts.
This is what I live for, fighting your own kind. Nothing's more gratifying.
Only to feel vague regret later when he hits the reality that he's killed another person.
Wait a minute. Are you getting a little sentimental? Still green, aren't you? You know this is only the beginning.
Call me when the next one's arranged.
Travis likewise idealizes Sylvia as a sex object, so we see her as a sex object. I think it's even fair to argue that the Sylvia we see during her conversations with Travis is his projection of her, how he imagines she is during that call. We have no idea what the reality of Sylvia's body is because we only perceive it through Travis's fantasy. Travis doesn't know her body like he knows his own, so he doesn't have the counter-evidence of reality, the counter-evidence of hygiene, to balance out that fantasy. No More Heroes seems to equate video games with pornography, and Travis filters reality through each. Pornography as a fantasy only works because the performers are objectified. Action games as fantasy only work because we objectify our avatars. As objects, porn and action game characters don't get meaning because of who they are, like people or literary characters. They get their meaning from the scenarios that the audience discovers them through. There's an old joke about writing in video games that it's like writing in porn because everyone expects it to be there, but no one's there for the story. And obviously, as a writer, I don't share that opinion for video games generally, but that observation highlights the overlap between porn and action game characters as objects. Those scenarios exist for the sake of the anonymous audience, and that promotes a kind of egotism that does not translate well into developing real relationships. And this is where Travis's character turns into social critique. He doesn't know who Sylvia is because he doesn't care. He's cast her as a player in his personal story, and the boundaries of her role are so fixed that he never even asks the first question anyone would ask when pursuing someone romantically. Do they have room in their life for this?
When did you two get married?
Oh, about 10 years ago. Yeah, that's right. Because we were both in college at the time.
No More Heroes works as a critique of self-indulgent masculinity when it dramatizes the social ineptness of a man who sees other people not as people, but as players in his own drama. Men are often encouraged to treat the world as a theater for their power fantasies. Taken to an extreme, this, somewhat sociopathically, reduces other people to roles in the story of their personal growth into power. This has especially bad consequences in the face of romantic rejection, particularly if a guy has assigned a woman a role in his personal story without her knowledge. Any evidence that her behavior or speech exists outside the narrow confines of his personal story is taken as a personal attack, and it gets pretty ugly.
Rules are rules. You can't have what you can't have.
Travis is an apotheosis of this kind of egotism. I can respect his use of anime fantasy as a kind of personal mythology that he uses to understand the world around him, but the dark side of that mode of perception is an inability to understand others as entities outside of what they mean to him.
She'll grow up. Why not kill her when she's stronger? Yeah, then I'll kill her.
I think this is the weightiest critique against male gamers in No More Heroes, and I think that critique is directed specifically toward that audience because it's the audience the game specifically names.
What do you say, bro? Join me. Let's see how far we can take this.
To avoid that point is to avoid the game, which is not our purpose here. We share reality with others, and our individual perceptions are colored by the fantasies that give our lives meaning, our myths. But if we seek only the fulfillment of fantasy, we cease sharing reality. Taking No More Heroes as satire, this criticizes gamers as indulgent to the exclusion of others. And Travis's image of Sylvia as a pornographic object points to the social disconnect that occurs when gamers attempt to relate to the real world with the same self-centeredness flattered by their power fantasy games. And gosh, that's one of the reasons why I love this game. The rawness of this critique is highlighted by the fact that it's maintaining eye contact the whole time with the very people it's critiquing. It's got a lot of guts, which I respect. And with that respect, I'm closing out the critical intro and moving to the interview mic to speak with this episode's guest. Joining me today is Shonté Daniels. Shonté is the editorial assistant at RH Reality Check, a games journalist and poet. Her work has appeared on Killscreen, Motherboard, Sufficiently Human, and other places besides. Shonté, welcome.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Yeah, your stuff is super cool. It's really rare to find somebody who is versed, so to speak, in poetry and able to apply that to game analysis. I really liked your piece on Killscreen about the transition from modernism to confessional poetry, drawing a line between that and the transition from more impersonal games that use blank slate characters to personal games that have definite characters or definite personalities that you're sharing experience with. Really sharp work.
Thank you. I really enjoyed writing that one. It was also one I was very nervous about because I wrote that at a time where I was just starting to figure out why I felt poetry and games had a connection. So it was me really digging into my thoughts and figuring it out, because I've been thinking that way for a long time, but for a long time I couldn't explain what I was thinking. It was just kind of a feeling I had, because I love poetry and then I love games, and I always felt there was something there. And I'm finding more people that agree with me, which is really nice. So thank you.
Yeah, the risk involved was certainly worth it. That's the kind of conversation that I really like to see happening. Unfortunately, poetry is more—it's just more niche now than a lot of other art forms. I mean, essays comparing video games to film are like a dime a dozen.
Right. I think that's not fair. I mean, I think games have a lot to learn from other art forms. Especially poetry. And poetry has been around for so long. I think there's so many things we could learn about the history of poetry and also theater and sometimes dance. And I mean, poetry is just the thing that I love the most, so I can talk the most about it. But I would love more pieces that talked about, you know, ways you could think about games through theater or anything, really. Except for film. I'm tired of movies and games.
I think we're also reaching a point where the creative backgrounds of people who make games are more varied. I know that on the Japanese side, a lot of the earlier designers had mainly visual art backgrounds, so you've got people like Toriyama putting his stamp on Dragon Ball and Dragon Quest alike. So yeah, those creative backgrounds tended to inform the stories the games told, as well as how those stories were told. But now that game making has become possible outside of a heavily moneyed industry, we can approach games from non-visual backgrounds with less of the traditional risk involved. But yeah, there's not as much influence specific to poetry as there might be.
Yeah, I think the most known, I would say, is Nina Freeman, who just released Sybil. And she's really known for her personal stories and personal games. And I think that makes sense if, you know, coming from a poetry background, I think it would make sense that, you know, her games would be like that. And other than that, I don't really know anyone else that comes in that background, because games are usually seen as another movie. You know, everything is so cinematic now, and everything must be big and boom and instead of, you know, quiet and personal. Even though we can have both, really, but as far as popular titles go, it seems people lean more towards the cinematic than
right.
than the personal stories.
Yeah. One of the things that draws me to this game, when I was trying to think about something that I wanted to do a project on, one of the things that sort of drew me to No More Heroes is it seems to have a mix of a lot of those things. It's got the big, bright, flashy explosions. It also seems to be skeptical of them.
Mm-hmm.
Skeptical of them without being 100% ironic. To whatever extent there's a voice communicating to the audience, it's not like forward-facing. It's not talking directly to you, except in very few circumstances. There's kind of what I think of as a personal intelligence behind mm-hmm. it that I feel is worth trying to figure out what might be being said there.
Yeah, I agree. And I also agree in that regard for Suda's other game, Killer 7, which is my favorite game from Suda. And I think that's mostly because I don't understand everything in that game.
Yeah.
I don't know what's going on in that game. But it's something, I don't know, it's a game that I always go back to and I try to read and I'm like, okay, I'm going to understand it now completely, and I don't. But I love the characters. I love Garcian Smith. He is my absolute favorite. And the ending of that game, I love to death. And I love Mask de Smith. He's one of my favorites. I could just gush about that game, even though if you asked me what happens, I'd be like, I don't know. But I just think both games are both flashy and follow popular game tradition, and yet also stray away from it. And it's harder to see that. It's something you have to really look for. And that's what I really like, a game that looks like it's going to follow the path, and then it takes you on a completely different turn once you pay attention to it.
Yeah, definitely. Killer 7 got some guff for this, which I thought was really unfair, but having an unorthodox control scheme, you know, you press a single button to move forward, that's just so interesting.
Mm-hmm. The whole, and it was so confusing of that, it's kind of like you can only go certain ways. It's like some sort of kind of puzzle game, and you hear the laughing in the background, and you have to look for where that's coming from. And
yeah.
And it's, you know, the fact that you can play as these different people, but you shouldn't play as Garcian because he's more of a healer kind of person. He'll pick up people who are dead. And I love that. And the fact also that he's black, and a lot of black men in games tend to be treated as animals, you know.
Yes.
They're animalistic, big, bulky, loud, and then there's Garcian, who's very clean in his white suit, and you know, he's here to pick up bodies. You know, if he's the last character you have, then you're screwed, because he's not meant to be the fighter.
Right.
And I love that. I could just gush about that game.
Totally. Oh, 100%. I respect what they did with that character direction for those same reasons.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of Kaidi. I think that's how you pronounce her name.
That's as close as I can get.
Okay. I wasn't a fan of how they portrayed her, especially since she's the only female character in the Killer 7. But as far as Garcian goes, I'm like, yes. And another thing with that is Mask de Smith. His voice is very quiet, and he's not... You know, when you think luchador, you think loud wrestler, but he's not that. And
yeah,
it feels like another rejection of you assume he's going to be this way, and then he's not. I love that.
Yeah. He has a kind of gentle giant feel to him.
Yeah.
Which is very strange for somebody whose character type has a background of flashy violence.
Mm-hmm. But, but I do just... really enjoy Killer 7 for how much, pretty much the same as No More Heroes, how much it rejects a lot of traditional paths, I guess, or traditional mechanics, while also using those traditional mechanics to reveal something new.
You wrote on one of your kill screen bios that you look for poetry in games or overlaps between poetry and video games. And that seems like something at first glance that would be easier to find in more intimately developed projects, such as an indie game. And I know that you've written recently about the beginner's guide on Lana Polonsky's Sufficiently Human, which focuses on both the conversation that game seems to have about art, but also embedded in that is a discussion of the personal closeness of that game, the I guess vulnerability might be a word for it. But, and you've also mentioned interest in confessional poems and like the poetry of Lee Young Lee. So how does that inclination affect how you approach a AAA title? Do you find that looking for poetry in a game or those overlaps is different in this kind of circumstance?
Huh, that's a good question. I think it's definitely been easier for me to find overlaps in poetry and games when it comes to indie games, definitely. Just because, as you said, you know, AAA titles tend to, I feel, worry more about the player than the game sometimes. It's just that tendency in indie games to, I guess, because there is less money to be able to have those risks, and I guess in those risks, I tend to see more overlaps in poetry. So when it comes to these bigger titles, there's definitely poetry in them. It's just, well, I guess I should say not every game has poetry in them. It's not one-to-one. Every game will have a piece of poem in it. But it's definitely still there somewhere in a lot of AAA titles. It's just a little harder for me personally to find them. But I do still try to find them because I don't think a AAA title, just because it's bigger budget, means all of a sudden that it's less of a piece of art. It's just perhaps a more popular piece of art. I've been thinking about that with No More Heroes, if something in it sparks me as that. And I do. When I think about No More Heroes, I think about how it rejects being an open world game while also being open world. I love the fact that it has this big map. There are so many buildings here that you just can't do anything with. they're just there. And I love that the only reason why you do anything outside of fighting the bosses is to help you fight the boss. So, you know, I love that these side missions are only there to get you more money so you can fight the boss. You know, the mini games, more money. There's nothing for you to do other than fight these bosses. And that rejection feels very, I can't say it reminds me of a poetic form per se, but that rejection feels very much like art to me. That's a very vague sentence.
I really like that, actually, because poetic form is, you know, it's language, this really messy thing given a shape, and kind of a game form shapes, I guess, experience. But yeah, one of those things about form, like, say you're reading a sonnet. Yeah, you go in knowing that it's a sonnet. So that foreknowledge sets you up to expect a certain rhyme or rhythm, which combines with the, you know, semantic meaning of the words to make something happen in your head. And how a poem plays with that expectation is one place where its character can really come through. So, no, I like that. I think that's a cogent parallel.
And also, this might also be because of the era that this game is in, but I just love how everything is so blocky, and I love the dark shades. I love how boring this area looks.
Yeah.
I love that there's nothing to do. It's something that rejects everything about open world. This is not Grand Theft Auto, and I just, it's so interesting to me that it does that. And I personally don't know if it's like that, perhaps because Suda51 couldn't do much with the world, but I'm kind of happy it came out this way, because I think it's really great for the aesthetic of No More Heroes.
Yeah, and to build on what you're saying, you know, typically the open world format pairs that freedom and variety with a sort of, with a character who's a blank slate during the player's roaming actions, but who then later reacquires a personality when the player has to advance story missions. But the character usually exists for the open world rather than the other way around, is my feeling. So I guess what I'm trying to build off that with is, if the open world in No More Heroes messes with the open world form, that would change, I guess, how we understand Travis as part of that form.
Yeah, I think definitely when I think about Travis, I don't think of the typical open world hero or open world protagonist. I feel like he is, I don't know, I just feel like everything he does, it's just because of luck of he happened to be at the right place at the right time, and now he's an assassin trying to go to rank number one. And it's just really interesting to see that, I guess, when thinking about open world, just because, well, really, I haven't played too many open world games, so I so I guess I can't really speak too much about that. But I agree with you. I do think it's another example of rejecting the kind of key factors that are usually in open world games.
Yeah, I think that reading it as breaking form is a lot more interesting than the normal explanation, which is, you know, they just ran out of budget and development time.
But that's like one of the beauties of having no money. You know, it's those
yeah.
It's the limitations that really that exactly is what poetry is. It's limitation. It's what defines poetry from fiction. With fiction, when you write a book, you can use as many words as you want, and I don't want to, you know, imply that fiction is a bunch of rambling nonsense, because, you know, you still have to pick what you write about, but you have so many more pages, so much more space you can work with. Poetry usually is one page, two pages, you know, it has line breaks. It's all about keeping it short, keeping it quick, keeping it concise, and games don't have that, especially AAA titles. You know, AAA titles are about the more money, the bigger the budget, the better. And that's why,
right. That's
why when games have such a smaller budget, in a lot of cases, I feel, those limitations help the developer figure out, okay, what can we do with the money we have? How can we make this great with what we can do? And in this case, if the lack of money is what caused the boring environment, then that's great, because I just love the fact that it feels like a rejection to me. It's like, this is open world, but it's also not open world, and it feels great to me.
Yeah, how about it?
All right.
I want to look briefly at the mechanical side of Shinobu's fight in a second, but I've never really thought about this before, but it now seems strange to me that someone as tough as she is ranked 8.
Yeah, when it comes to these fights, I've never actually thought about it either, except for Dr. Peace, I think, because he is also one of my favorites. And I always thought it was interesting that Shinobu comes after him, because he is a father who is mourning pretty much the relationship he has with his daughter. And then here comes Shinobu, which is the opposite of that.
Holy cow!
I always figured that was why they were together, you know, back to back.
You got no idea how hard it is to hide your true self around here.
Hey, I'm not accusing anybody.
The way that her boss fight is done, and this is another parallel between her and Travis, she has a lot of the skills that Travis ostensibly does. When you're playing Travis to the fullest extent that the game allows, you are doing a lot of dark stepping. Either you faint, either right before or right after an enemy attacks, and you're kind of in bullet time, except with a lightsaber, and you connect a whole bunch of attacks in rapid succession. Taking that from an outside point of view, if you saw Travis doing that, it would look like he's just zipping around like crazy. And he's also got some counters and some parries, and that is uniquely very much how Shinobu behaves. I mean, she is just like a flea, just like jumping around, and and she's murderous.
What the hell was that?
Something that emphasizes that is what we're looking at right now. Each boss, you can have a sword clash sequence, and there are four possible outcomes for her. One is you clash and you lose, which she bounces you like a tennis ball. Second, you clash and you win, and she uniquely will duck out of the riposte. And then third, and this is horrifying, even if you win and you try to do the riposte, she will enter into an unblockable move where she slices Travis all up. And she's the only boss outside of Jean where doing what you're supposed to is not rewarded. This fight takes Travis down to 1% of health, as opposed to the 100% of other fights. typically like to record as much high-level play as I can for entertainment value, but Travis getting worn down to a nub, that's what Shinobu is. Shinobu is fighting with a lot of passion.
I think the way she is matches very well with the environment that she's in because of this, I don't know, this dilapidated school feels right in a different way than the other environments feel right for the other fighters, I guess. Apparently they give them, these assassins, the money to kind of be where they want, I believe.
Yeah.
And then it makes me wonder, why is Shinobu in this dilapidated old school? But I feel like this school is just matches really well with Shinobu, not just because she was in a school when we see her. It's something about how run down this place is.
If I'm understanding right, it sounds like you're saying like that dilapidation is in some way a reflection of her?
I think so. Like, inside, yes. I wouldn't be surprised if inside, you know, with how strong she is probably hurting. I mean, I think that's obvious with how quickly she wants to avenge her father. And I think it's interesting thinking about it too, because we meet her in a school that's obviously running, you know, students are there, and they seem to only walk a few steps to get to this. And so that's one working school right next to this broken down school. Feels like Shinobu. It feels like we meet her and we see her in, you know, this school that is up and it's running and it's great. And then when we fight her in her real state, which is this, you know, rundown old school.
Yeah, that connects to one of the first things that she says when they're walking over to the old school. Travis is asking her why she just slaughtered her fellow students without their being able to defend themselves. And her response is like, you've got no idea how hard it is to hide your true self around here.
Exactly.
And that difference between appearance and reality, that fits what you're saying. It sounds like there's that... maybe dissonance would be a word for it? Contrast.
Yeah, contrast, I would say.
In terms of her recognizing Travis as the target of her revenge, I guess I could find a wiki on the internet that would answer this. But in terms of like how she recognizes Travis, she sort of gets that look in her eye, like you will pay with your life when he activates the laser sword. And I mean, I guess there's an implied backstory there that her dad was killed by somebody with a laser sword. But her backstory never seems to be followed up on. We never find out what the story with her dad and really, in a sense, her story is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've always wondered about that. It's one of the things that frustrates me about how No More Heroes uses Shinobu. Another thing is, and this is just maybe me, but I don't think she deserves to be rank 8. I think she deserves a higher rank. But
oh my god, yes.
just thinking about, you know, how strong she does not deserve the low rank that she is, but I do think she is just around for Travis. First, she's around because she wants to have revenge on her father, who Travis knows and respects, and then she comes back at the end to help Travis, and then in the next game she comes back again to help Travis, and then when she has agency and she says, and she pretty much wants Travis, you know, as a lover, and he rejects her, she's gone again.
Oh, that's right.
there's nothing for her. There's, her father's gone, her potential lover rejects her, there is no room for her. And that's just really frustrating because she obviously is capable of everything. Like, she is just as strong, I feel, as Travis, and the only reason why Travis beat her is because she had to be beaten for the game to proceed. As much as I love No More Heroes because it has a lot of female assassins, which I really appreciated, I feel like the game just does her wrong. So wrong.
I want to touch on that. The point I was making before I lose it, because that will happen, is she seems to be subject to a lot of the problems of sort of, I guess, the way that female characters are written in terms of scripting, that her motivations are that of a daughter and a lover, which she exists with respect to her relationship to other men. I don't want to be reductive and typecast her as a trope, but that does really slight how fucking terrifying she is.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of like I'm perfectly fine with her. I don't want to say I'm perfectly fine, but I'm fine with the fact that she lives with this relationship with, you know, she's doing this for her father, she's doing this for Travis. I'm kind of okay with that. No problem. I was just saying, I'm fine with her having this relationship, you know, to avenge her father or to help Travis. I'm kind of okay with that because of how vicious she is. How, you know, she's brutal. She has a lot of skill. Watching her, you know, just in this battle alone, just watching this battle is awesome. I don't know what other word to say other than awesome because of how difficult she is. She really won't back down, so I don't know. It's one of those, I wish she had more agency, but I also love at least what she has now.
When we were talking before the recording, you mentioned specifically that you had thoughts on Shinobu's hair.
Yeah, well, just thinking about the graphics in No More Heroes and how, you know, boxy it is, the simple shapes, I think it's really easy to give a black person like Shinobu, you know, an afro, because, you know, that would be the easiest thing to do. And I really appreciate the fact that they did not do that. It's, you know, her hair is, obviously it's still puffed in an afro-like shape, you know, it's really big on the top of her head, but it's also white, and it has these little pieces that kind of poke out, so it's not this, you know, very, it's not an even afro, as, you know, people would assume an afro to be this very circular thing. It's kind of this pointy-looking thing that I would say her hair looks like what I would do if I did a twist out, which is when I twist my hair up, let it dry, and then I take the twists out and puff it out, and I would kind of have what she has, but a little curlier and a little more defined, obviously, because No More Heroes graphics aren't the most defined, but...
Right.
Yeah. But I, you know, I think it goes, too, to the fact that Shinobu is not the stereotypical black little girl. You know, she, other than being, you know, this strong person that she is physically... She is also a little emotionally weak in the fact that she, you know, is doing this for her father. She's obviously mourning the death of her father. And a lot of people worry when they think about black women in games, there's that stereotype of, you know, the angry black woman.
Right.
And she's definitely angry, but I feel like that anger is, I don't want to say deserved. I think it's appropriate is what I mean to say. I understand why she's angry. I understand why she is as strong as she is. And I feel like it all fit. I guess for me, her hair is also a part of that in the fact that she is not what you expect of a black woman. Another thing to go off of that is... In No More Heroes 2, there is another character who is a black man, and I think his name is Nathan Copeland?
Yes.
And so he's this black musician, and in his cutscene, there are two women with him. I believe they're in bikinis, and they have, you know, the afro that I'm talking about, you know, that cyclical afro.
Right.
And she's, you know, they're obviously meant to be his groupies. And then he kills them in the cutscene. He beheads them and throws them at Travis. And, you know, that's just a kind of another example of the type of violence that happens, you know, both in real life and in the game, I suppose, you know, that violence towards women and black women. And then we have Shinobu, who is this strong woman who, you know, in this game, she's very hard to beat. She's one of the strongest assassins that Travis has to defeat. And then in the second game, she's become so strong that she takes Travis's place, you know, for a few ranks. And so, really, it's just, I really love what they did with Shinobu, with her character, and I appreciate how she turned out.
You know, weirdly enough, I've read a few people describe her as Ganguro rather than black, which I don't think that's right, but Ganguro being a fashion style where a woman darkens her skin and uses bright, loud hair dye and makeup like Shinobu's lipstick.
Yeah, I don't necessarily see that, and of course I'm not too familiar with that fashion, but in my head I've always just seen her as, you know, a black girl. And, you know, knowing the history of Suda and the different races and ethnicities that have been used in previous Suda 51 games, I feel like it's more likely that she is, you know, just a black girl with, you know, white hair.
Right.
And I also love the fact that she has a flower in her hair, but on her shirt she has a blood stain.
Yeah.
Which I always thought, you know, because, and this might just be me looking at things too closely, as I tend to do, but it just seems so interesting that there's that delicate touch of the flower on her, in her white hair, and then on her white shirt there's the blood stain. And in my head I think stability when I think the flower, and then that blood I think instability, as far as like emotions go. As we talked about before, you know, with the two schools where we meet her in a new school and then we fight her in this dilapidated old school, feels like another symbol of what she's going through.
Liar! You killed him! Sliced him in two, you sick bastard!
The blood is, in a way, it's also kind of a symbol of her angst, given where it comes from, I think. It's the start of her leaving the open, clean world of the new school and descending with Travis into that darker old school, because she kills those girls at the head of the classroom when Travis approaches for the ranking fight.
Another thing, thinking about that scene where she kills those girls, I've always thought it was interesting that she's sitting in the front and she's facing them, or they're facing her. So I always thought she was tutoring them, because there's no one else in that classroom except for them.
Yeah.
Or, you know, perhaps they're her friends and she's talking to them, but the way they're set up, the three girls are facing Shinobu, who's sitting in front of them, and that always gave me a teacher vibe from her, someone who is educating them or talking to them about something,
right.
Which I always made me wonder, you know, what were they talking about? Why was she there in the first place? And that might also have to do with her identity, you know, as, you know, when she's walking with Travis to their area where they eventually fight, she says, you have no idea how hard it is to hide your true identity here. Maybe, you know, maybe she's the really smart one that teaches, you know, everyone what's going on in class.
Yeah.
But it was just something that always interested me. It's something we don't see with any other fighter, I don't think, because usually all the other fighters are isolated already. So we just, you know, talk to them for a little bit and then fight. But in this case, it's Shinobu who has to turn off one persona to turn on the other.
Yeah,
really, really interesting.
Yeah, Travis is really catching her by surprise in her kind of her native element, whereas the others are really staged encounters. To comment real quick on what we're seeing on the screen here, and this connects back to what you were saying before, I really, really like all the detail they put into Shinobu's boss area. As fast-paced as the fight is, you're really not likely to see the details of these little nooks and classrooms because you're paying attention to her movements. I think the fact that you can look at it after the fact justifies that. I also think that the way that we're able to interact with that supports your observation, actually, about the environment reflecting her character or emotional condition. You know, we're free to check out the environment of a boss area after the fight, of course, for any of them. But I can't think of any others where you see this much inaccessible space so close at hand. It's kind of like, insofar as Shinobu's story is introduced without being totally resolved, we're kind of asked merely to bear witness to it without being able to follow through. It's kind of like this, it's this wound that we can't heal. Looking around this dilapidated school could be taken as another way of expressing our relationship as an audience to her character and her story. You know, we've been invited in on the pretense of conflict, but this is her space, and there are boundaries past which we cannot tread, but can only look across. Even in defeat, this is still hers. I'll that brings us to the end of our discussion of Shinobu. A lot of really fantastic new ideas. Shonté, thank you very much for joining me. I'm really glad you were able to join us on this.
Yeah, it was really great speaking with you about Shinobu and No More Heroes, so thank you.
See you next time, everyone.